depths of love that I cannot know till I cross a narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Depths and heights. Depths and heights. Got that? Depths and heights. But most of the time, we spend in the land in between the depths and the heights. And it's a very special time for us. We usually don't like being in between things. We don't like being between big trucks on the highway, right?
Yeah.
We don't like being between a rock and a hard place, for sure. And we don't like being between jobs. We don't like being between a hammer and a nail. That can really be painful. And we don't like being between human beings. Place. We just don't like to be in between. And I guess in life, if we could always live up here in the heights of joy and just success every day, and I'm talking about spiritual success, just all highlights. And this is one of the problems that we develop when we send our kids off to, say, Christian youth camp over the summer. They get down there at the camp, and it's just a whole week, usually, and they are having devotionals every day and Bible study every day and doing Christian things every day, and then they got to come home. And it's just, you know, and the Sunday morning and the services, and the preacher's so dry and boring, you know, and it's like, oh, if we could just be at camp all the time. And of course there's that other side too, the spiritual depths where, you know, we lose loved ones, we have sickness, we have financial problems, you know, there's war, there's persecution, all that stuff. We don't necessarily like that, but you know, that can happen to us. So however we look at things, that land in between is where we are going to spend most of our time, that land in between, and we do it without ever really realizing it. And sometimes, you know, I get to that moment, the danger that lurks in that land in between. While there are many highs and lows in our walk with Jesus, we spend most of the time in between the highest highs and the lowest lows. These long passages, that land of the in between, can intensify the highs and prepare us to survive the lows. It's what we do in that land of the in-between that's going to prepare us so that when the opportunity comes and a spiritual high is granted to us, man, we're ready for it. And it's just so great. And we're also prepared for those lows to survive it when bad things happen to us. And bad things do happen to good people. We understand that. But it's the land of in between, where we get prepared for both the highs to make them better and the lows simply to survive them. What do we want to do? And what do a lot of people want to do when they become Christians? They want to fly like eagles or run and never faint. That's Isaiah chapter 40, verses 28 through 31. I don't have it up there. Just referencing it. But we'll spend most of the time of our lives walking through the valley of the shadow of death with Jesus. We know that. We don't like to think of it, but that's what we're doing. Psalm 23, 4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That's what we do regardless. In spite of the highs, we know where we're headed. We're headed to a death. But more importantly, we're heading to the judgments. So that's what we have to be preparing for. We'll remember those flights of spiritual ecstasy and power. Remember when you were baptized? I hope you do, because that should have been the greatest moment of your life. Because now you've got fellowship with Jesus Christ. You have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. You have the forgiveness of sins. Man, that's great. Okay? Now that's starting point. Remember what happened to Jesus after he was baptized? Led out in the Spirit for 40 days, led by the Spirit out to the wilderness for 40 days, 40 nights, fasting, and the devil met him out there. He went out, the Holy Spirit took him out to meet the devil. Now, after we're converted, you know, because he wanted us back in a hurry. So, very important times there. Psalm 122, verse 1. Listen to this. Spiritual ecstasy and power. I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. Hey, it's a wonderful thing. Let's go for David. Let's go to the temple. Let's go up there. Well, it wasn't the temple there. It was the tabernacle. Well, let's go. Let's go where the people are gathering. Let's go where God's people are. And let's go worship God. That's going to be a wonderful thing. And, yeah, I know, Charlie, sometimes people come to get sleep at a sermon. You know, it's a good place to get a nap. But yet, it's something so very special. Now, we're with God all the time. Well, God's with us all the time. Jesus is with us always, even to the end of the age. But sometimes we forget that in the land in between. We forget that He's right there along with us. Now, what we're going to do with those good times, we're going to replay those over and over again. That's what the mind does. We replay the good times, and we also replay the bad times. We remember those heartbreaking situations that we get in. But we replay the hard races against our enemy. You know, and hopefully, you know, here's what the enemy did to us, but here's what helped me to survive. Here's what helped me to get through it. Psalm 59, verse 16. But I will sing of your strength, talking about God. I will sing aloud of your steadfast love in the morning, for you have been to me a fortress and a refuge in the day of my distress. Take that bad time, that day of distress, and turn it into a spiritual high. How do you do that? At God. Remember that God is there. Remember that Jesus is there in that land of in between. So when we get to the bad one, now we're prepared. Hey, we know bad things are going to happen. And I'm going to survive. I can survive. I know I can. I can get through this because my God is with me. What a wonderful thing. So however our souls must be nourished and our spirits fed in the land of in between, or we'll never reach our spiritual highs and we'll never survive our spiritual lows. If we just stick in there in the land of in between and we're just going on idle, we're not going to make it. It's going to crush us. So in that time period, we need to be preparing, feeding our souls, nourishing our souls and our spirits, so we can be prepared for whatever God's bringing our way. So our walk in the land of in between, this can be a dangerous thing. Why can it be a dangerous thing? Well, because we get comfortable with it. We get comfortable with the in between. I don't know how people can go to be a Christian and go to services for years and years and years. And I've heard of preachers who they'll preach for 30, 40 years. They get to be 70, 75, 80 years old, and they quit preaching, and then they just quit. They've done it. They quit going to services. They just quit. That's the end of it. I can't understand that people, because at that point, there ought to be a spiritual maturity that depends so much more on God. When we can get comfortable, it's a bad thing to get comfortable, because it's so easy to get moved out of that comfort zone. We take it for granted. We take this world, this land of in between, for granted, and it becomes familiar to us, and we like it. So that's what makes our stay here so important. We will live so much of our lives here in this land of in between, developing habits and settling into routines. Worship service ought to be a habit. It ought to be a routine. Now, not just a routine like they do at some churches where you just come in and you do the same thing. You stand up, sit down, do this, do that, whatever, you know, ritual, mindless, thoughtless, aimless, purposeless ritual. I got a sermon I'm going to preach one of these days. that's about, you know, should our worship be traditional or contemporary? And the answer is yes. Now you think about that. It should be traditional and it should be contemporary. All right? No surprises there when it happens. Okay? Routines. But getting into the routine. Yeah, baby, we get up. We know what time we pretty much need to leave camp to get here on time. So I don't have to drive 75 miles an hour. I can drive 65 and get better gas mileage. But we know, hey, let's leave at this time. This morning, Aaron, hey, let's leave about 15 minutes early. I go wash the car. So we're ready, prepared, and we're on a routine here. Nobody had a flat tire on the way. I did have to stop and move the trash bag out of the way. Didn't want anybody else. I didn't want to get it. Didn't want anybody else to do it by accident or whatever. So, but you know, it's here it is. This is what we need to do. This is what Christians would do. Because we know that that's what God would want for us to do. When the times of trial come, when moments of great accomplishment for God's kingdom are presented to us, what we've done to grow in the land of in between will determine where we come out in the end. The preparations that we make in that in between, in our daily lives, as we walk and as we grow. And that's what I've said before. Some years, get up. Sunday morning. And, alright, we're going to sing songs such to prepare our minds for the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Brothers and sisters, we have not prepared all week long. One song isn't going to get us there. We've got to be anxious and yearning for that time period, for that very special night. It's really no more important than any other part of the worship. We need to be here prepared to listen, prepared to sing, prepared to give, you know, all those things. That's the beauty of our worship. We get prepared for it, and then we can give God our best. I got another sermon to talk to you about. I got to preach that sometime, too. But, all right, so how do we get to that, or how do we learn that point? 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Listen to what Peter says. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? You want me to be zealous? Me to be filled with zeal? And that's a kind of like enthusiasm. It's part of it. It's God. Enthusiasm is God in us. But that's where it is. Am I enthusiastic? Do I have zeal for the service of God, for the worship of God? Not just on the first day of the week, but as we prepare for it. Verse 14, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, for doing the right thing, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. Verse 15, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy. Always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Turn on the TV and listen to some of these preachers, how they talk about their walk of life and what they're doing and how they do it and who they tell. It doesn't sound like there's gentleness and respect there. It sounds like they're trying to boast instead of trying to persuade people to the life that God has called us, that Jesus has called us to live. Right? Verse 16, having a good conscience so that when you are slandered, those who regard your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. You know, that's the thing that bothers me most. When somebody says something bad about me, and I know I deserve it. You know, somebody says something bad about me and it wasn't true, it hurts a little bit, but you know what? That's it. You know, it bothers me sometimes. You know, they hit the nail on the head, between the hammer and the nail, and yeah, they got me. verse 17, listen to this, for it is better to suffer for doing good. There that is again. It's twice in that passage, isn't it? Doing good. Well, where's the doing good? That's every day, isn't it? Every day of our lives, we have to know good so we can do good. But it's better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. Now listen, that's not doing God's will like people out in the world who don't understand God say, well, you know, something bad happened, well, that was God's will. No, it's God's will that in this life people suffer, that usually we suffer because we've done 20 stupid things to get to the point where we're really hurt. It's not God's will that we should suffer. God created mankind to put him in paradise. Now we're out in this fallen world because of sin. And we get hurt because of our sin. We get hurt lots of times because of our own stupidity. Now sometimes when we're doing good, that's not our stupidity. That's our dedication to God. And we get hurt for it because this world doesn't understand it. And that's the suffering. But what is this, if it be God's will, should it be God's will? Look what happened to the Christians in Jerusalem and the persecution that they faced under the Jews first. We talked about that this morning, didn't we, Lance? The persecution of the Jews. The Jews who became Christians lost everything. They were considered dead people to their family, their friends. They didn't have anything. The only one they could trust was God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and hopefully their brothers and sisters in Christ. Okay? Get rid of that persecution, and then we get broken persecution. But that was God's will. That was God's will because that was a test. That was a test for Christians to see whether they'd be strong enough to remain faithful. It's also a test of the Jews, and it's a test of the Romans to see how they would react so that when punishment did come upon them, just like Jesus said to Saul of Tarsus, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? You'd say, why are you persecuting the church? When they were persecuting the church, they were persecuting Jesus Christ. So, persecution may not be so much. It's going to be a test for us if it happens. If the time happens, it doesn't happen here very much, does it? Not like it is overseas, but a time, a test, a testing for us, and it's also a time testing for those who do those terrible acts against God's people. So, you see the critical need for preparation in this land in between so we can face those things. But in the land of in between, we should follow a spiritual regimen that prepares us for the heights and the valleys that will follow. Notice I didn't say routine, I said a regimen. Well, what's the difference between a routine and a regimen? Well, a routine is I might get up in the morning and have coffee and donuts for breakfast every day. That could be a routine. Is that a regimen? Well, it might be called a regimen, but you know, that's not good for you. Well, you gotta have some protein and, you know, some. And so a regimen is more like a diet that's really good for you. Not just routine stuff that's out there. A regimen, a plan. Jeremy and I were talking about plans yesterday. And it's very good. We had a very good conversation about in an automobile. What do you do? Okay, I pull up and say, I got to go into the bank in Walmart. So I leave him in the car. We've already been in Walmart. I pull up to a closer spot. I get out and I leave the keys in the car. I come back. He's got the car locked. I knock on the window. He unlocks it. He said, down a lot. Car wasn't running, just turned, you know, while they're getting the car started, you just, you don't let the car go, and that led him into a conversation about what would happen if there was a fire in the house, and he was in his room, and he opens the door. Do you have a plan? Do you have a plan for spiritual growth individually? For spiritual study, for spiritual enlightenment, for keeping in the way, for growing. That's the important thing, because it's here in this valley of the in-between that we're going to prepare for the heights and for the valleys that will follow. So what are some of the things that we need to do? What would be a spiritual regimen that would be good for us? Number one, be obedient to the clear word of God. Some things in God's word are hard to understand. That's what Peter said about the things that Paul wrote. Okay, so it's hard to understand. Doesn't mean you can't do what's clearly spoken. Do that, and here's the thing. Maybe if we really do the things that are clearly spoken, eventually the hard stuff will become clear to us. James says, but be doers of the word, not hearers only, because when you do that, you're just deceiving yourself. So, you know, it's good to know the word of God. It does no good to know the word of God if we don't keep it. So that's just one good of it. You know, kind of study. Number two, avoid every form of immorality. Why? Because it is spirit sapping. It'll get you tired, right? But that's fulfilling. Exercise can get you tired, but that's fulfilling. Sitting in a chair doing nothing can get you tired. That's not fulfilling, is it? If you want to be tired because you've got something to accomplish, because then you've got a feeling of accomplishment. You know, the mind is something great. The way that we talk to ourselves and encourage ourselves can go a long way in the actions that we have. And especially the spirit sapping just draws our spirit away. Oh, Lord, I just can't do blah, 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 blah. But, you know, because we can't do everything, that's what we can't do. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. Finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God, listen, I don't want you to do anything to please me. Just as you're doing, that you do so. Work. I'm doing it. How do I do more and more if I'm doing it? Just ask God for help. He'll show you the way. He'll give you something. He'll give you a spiritual high, or he'll give you a valley to walk through. Okay? Verse 2. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification. What does that mean? You're being set apart for holy use. Watching the debate a while back, somebody had was talking about the Jews being the holy people of God. And one of the debaters said that, and the other debater said, oh, boy, they were holy when they were persecuting the church. And couldn't mix the two. It's because they had what I believe is an unscriptural understanding of the word holy, because the word holy means set apart for God's use. Yes, Israel was set apart for God's use. They had a purpose. It doesn't mean they fulfilled it in their lives, individually. Were they a holy people? Were they set apart so that the Messiah could come through that lineage? Yes, they were. Were they perfect? Absolutely. One made it, right? And that was that Messiah. So when he says, be holy, you know, sometimes we strive so much to be perfect. We strive so much to be perfect that when we're imperfect, then we have being set apart for God's use means that when we do something wrong, we make it right. We make it right. That's being set apart from the world, because the other way is the way the world handles it. So, for this is the will of God, your sanctification. So how do we achieve, what are elements of that being set apart for God's use? Number one here, that you abstain from sexual immorality. Number two, that each of you know how to control his own body in holiness, that set apartness and honor. Self-control. How many times does Peter talk about self-control? That's part of the fruit of the Spirit. It's part of the virtues that we're to add to your faith virtue, the virtue of knowledge. Self-control's in there also, isn't it? Okay. Same thing. Now, verse 5. Not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. So we need to know God, that our passions have to be for the right thing, not for the physical things, material things, but for spiritual things. Verse 6, that no one transgress and wrong his brother in this matter. If you go back and you read the entire context of that, brothers, don't fool another man's wife. Sisters, don't fool another man's wife. No belong to you. And that's even before you get married to them. That's before. We say something like, well, those two people were just made for one another. Well, that may be true, may not be true, it doesn't matter. Whoever you marry is the one you're supposed to give those sexual gifts to. In fact, one book that came out several years ago was that sex is a gift that God gives a couple. So that's is that a way of sanctification? Well, sure it is, okay? Because the Lord is an avenger in all these things. Okay? There you go. You mess with another man's wife, you don't have to worry about the other man. You better worry about the Lord. He's going to take care of it. As we told you beforehand and solemnly warned you, and I believe that's about all of those things. So, for God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness, to be set apart for his use. Therefore, whoever disregards this, disregards not man, but God, who gives his Holy Spirit to us. He gives it to us, and what do we do? And just like Saul, he didn't know the Spirit of God. That's a sad thing. People who, as Christians, they just don't know that. It's hard to tell, right? It's hard to tell. Because we don't have miraculous gifts of the Holy Spirit anymore. But take him away. Number three, okay, guard your speech and attitude, especially about other brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's a tough thing to do, because sometimes they can be dry. Get a chance sometime to read a book. It's how to deal with people. We're the unintended dragons in the church. Okay? And you begin to spot them, but then again, if you know it, then it's easier to get through it, because there are brothers and sisters in the church of the church and they're able to bear our problem. Okay? And don't make their problem your problem. I've done it in the past, I shouldn't have, but I have. So anyway, Ephesians 4, 25-13, listen to this. Therefore, having put away falsehood, don't lie to one another, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, not just brothers in Christ, but neighbors. We are members one of another. Be angry and do not sin. We're going to be angry at times, aren't we? Because that's natural. We've got a sermon on that too. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. And give no opportunity to the devil, because that's what that does. That opens the door to him. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up. This fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Don't set out and hurt anybody. Be a man. Don't set out to do something, set out to help somebody. That's just me. That'll change their attitudes. That's part of that walking in that land in between. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave. We receive the capacity. Number four, do what releases the power of the Holy Spirit from your life. Listen, it's not what these people out here say. It's not what you see in these churches on TV. That's not how you release the power of the Holy Spirit. How do you do it? It's the things we've been talking about, that spiritual regimen of the everyday life. Listen to this, Ephesians 5, 17 through 31, long passage, I know. It's worth reading it. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Well, how do we do that? How can we get filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, addressing one another in songs, in spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart with the Lord. That's a good place to start, isn't it? A merry heart, it makes good medicine, doesn't it? Sure does. Verse 20, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, be thankful. Be thankful for what you got. Not ungrateful for what you don't have, or angry because you don't have. Okay. Verse 21, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. There's the thing. If we submit to one another, if one has a problem, and three or four of us say, hey, you've got a problem, you want to help me out, submit. There might be something in my life that I don't see. That my wife's going to wait. I mean, that somebody's going to help me out. I need to be aware. It hurts. It hurts my feelings. It's not about the feelings, though, is it? It's about my spirit. About my soul. Verse 22. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Not because he's boss. Because if anything goes wrong, he gets the blame. That's pretty much what that means. Okay? Who should be the husband's best counselor, most trusted counselor for life? When the decision's made, it's his decision. If anything goes wrong, he gets the blame.
Yeah.
That's what it is, Charlie. I'm sorry. Wives, submit to your own husbands, ask the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, and is even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself as splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy. What's that? That she might be set apart for God's use, right? Holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourished. There's that nourishment. How does he nourish it? Where does he nourish it? In the land of in between, right? The spiritual things, the things we talked about earlier. Nourishes it and cherishes it just as Christ does the church. He's doing that for me. And I get to pass it on. Because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. That's part of that spiritual regimen for sanctification and for the Holy Spirit. the power of the Holy Spirit be unleashed in our lives. Now imagine how if we don't do that, you know, if the wife doesn't submit to the husband, the husband doesn't love the wife as he should, what's that do to the Spirit? Ephesians 6:17-18, and take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication, to that end keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. So what do we do? We sing, we give thanks, we submit to others, we open ourselves up to the Word of God, and we pray. That's how we unleash the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. It's nothing about miraculous gifts. It's about our response to what Christ has done and the gifts that's given to us then as we walk in that plan of in between preparing for the heights and for the depths. Get together with Christians for spiritual worship and fellowship. Okay, very quickly. Hebrews 10:19-25. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not stir one another up to contentions and strife and hate. Not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day drawing near. So after we do all those things, say, to unleash the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, here's something that's more important. That's just as important. Get together with other Christians for the worship and fellowship. And conclusion, while we would love to always be on the mountaintops with God, or soaring on the wings of eagles, experience teaches us that much of our time will be spent in the land in between. So if you find yourself here, then why not make your time here useful? And so that when the times for peaks and valleys come, ready to live for God, which means what? It says sanctified life is the life that's set apart from God's. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. The lesson is yours if you have